You're going to take a look here. We saw him on the bubble screen, which he's going to come out here. These two come out, and usually they stock block, but this time, DeMastro is going to stock, and then he's going to go. Stocks a little bit, and then he catches the corner looking into the backfield, but pretty well defended by Miles White, not biting on it. It's just another option off the bubble screen. You see a lot of teams try to throw it out there, get two-on-one matchup. That time, they try to get over the top.
Cougars 4-for-6 on third down so far today. Third down and 7 now. Lovett will throw and connect with Hutch for a first down. Needed 7, got 10.
Can you say Wes Welker? That's the way Hutch plays. The fine receiver for the New England Patriots, not very big in stature, but great quickness. And watch him, he's going to come out of a little out cut here to work some inside. And it's not about how fast you go into a cut to get open, it's how fast you come out of a cut. I had a chance to play with an all-pro tight end named David Hill. Couldn't run a 5-1-40. He'd lumber down the field, but when he made his cut, he was like a cat. He came out of it and got separation.
Enough separation there for Rodney Hutch to pick up another first down. Cougars continue to march. Shelby continues to drive inside the 30. Joe Dillette in on another tackle. Had 80 coming into the ball game. And Rob, you've mentioned his name numerous times, but Shelby looks good, doesn't he?
He sure does. He's one of those rotor tillers. Not moving a lot at times, not looking very fast, keeps the legs churning, starts chewing up a little bit of earth. And that time we saw him come out the other end for a nice 6-7 yard gain.
Second and 4 now. Shelby again, but a flag flies.
Remember yesterday we highlighted the size of Martin Luther King's offensive line. Well, they would be the second biggest offensive line in the state championships this year.
False start. Offense, still second down.
Dakota averages 6'3", 270 pounds across the front. And they're going against a much smaller defensive line for Stevenson, which averages around 220 pounds. Take Chris Galanka out of the equation because he's 3'10", he really skews it.
Starts to weigh on you after a while, no pun intended. Love it, looking deep, throwing deep for his tight end, but out of reach. Well, you understand why Kwiatkowski is such an athlete and a good basketball player. He can jump, but he's got a way of getting open, doesn't he?
Well, he runs pretty well. 6'5", doesn't, you know, look quick, but he's a long strider, so he is covering territory, getting down the field. He's able to get to that third level in the secondary, get past the safety. And what a weapon for that man right there, Mike Giannone, to have a tight end who could also get vertical. Teams cannot play cover two against you because you got three people, the tight end and two wideouts, who all can get down the field and stretch those halves, so you're forced into some different coverages.
Love it on the verge of 200 yards through the air. Threw for almost 2,000 this season. Setting up a screen, well placed, but well covered too by the Spartans. Second effort for Shelby, got him close to the first down.
Well, this is a screenplay. What looks like poor offensive line blocking isn't going to be, because these guys are going to release and get out in front of the screen. Defensive linemen think, oh, I'm getting penetration. All of a sudden, they get through, and all the big fellas are getting out. But he actually didn't get out quite, they didn't time up too well. Shelby really beat the lineman there, and he was forced to do most of this on his own with extra effort. How important is this spot right here? Wait for Joey to make the call up top, but he doesn't. And I don't think you could get a credit card in there, could you?
Wow. Doesn't get a whole lot closer than that, does it?
Man, Mr. Shelby. Maybe a little too close for call for his liking that time, but it's all on his own. As I said, he got hit about 7 yards away from first down, made a nice spin move, kept his balance, drove, dove, and was able to move the chains, and this Dakota offense just seems to keep on rolling.
Probably would have gone for it on fourth down anyway, but that's not a concern now. Hush jogs in motion, settles down in the slot. Lovett looks that way. All kinds of time across the middle. DeMaster, touchdown!
Well, let's pick your poison. We talked about, and you also heard the coaches talk about DeMaster running to the post, clearing to the outside with Hush to the corner. And simple X play for the two wideouts. Not very well defended that time by Stevenson.
Extra point is academic. Four touchdown drives for the defending champion Cougars. Four touchdown passes for Mitch Lovett, two of them to Kyle DeMaster. And it's a 21-point lead.
Well, the Lovett to DeMaster combination has struck again. And this play is pretty well designed. It's going to be an X play outside between DeMaster and his cohort. You're going to see right here in the slot, you're going to get a corner route to clear. And then DeMaster, he's going to run the post. And then the football is going to go from there to there for a touchdown. The motion comes to the play side. Nice job clearing to the corner, back to the post. The ball is delivered on time. When they execute like that, it makes the game look pretty easy.
And it's been looking easy for Mitch Lovett. The four touchdown passes today ties Mill Coleman's Harrison record when they beat St. Joseph in the 1988 Class B state championship.
Now, am I getting old? Does he look about 12? Look at that young man. He just looks like a kid fresh out of junior high on the biggest stage that the state of Michigan high school football has to offer. And he's just like he's playing in the backyard, hanging out with his friends and throwing touchdowns, a lot of them.
Throws like he's 22, though. Nine plays, 65-yard drive in just under 4.5 minutes. Lovett to DeMaster for the second time today, the 11th time this season. And now the Spartans from Livonia Stevenson must answer, because they don't look like they can slow down this high-octane offense that is Macomb, Dakota.
Now, sometimes the term must drive, crucial drive, critical drive gets overused, but this is one. When you're down three touchdowns against a team that you really haven't slowed down since the opening couple possessions of the game, it's vital that you answer the bell here and put 7 points on the board. Happy birthday.
Ball will start at the 35-yard line for Livonia Stevenson because the kickoff went out of bounds. Menominee and Jackson Lumen Christie to follow. Mitchell White, pressure from the corner and underthrew his younger brother Austin. And that's what you were talking about, Rob. Pressure from the edge. Justin Hughes applied it and made Mitchell White deliver it before he wanted to.
Well, if you can stop a quarterback from ever creating a comfort zone in the pocket, with people in his face, people hitting him, forcing the scramble, it's a difficult position to play, and that's exactly what Dakota's done defensively with this front seven, with whether it's rushing four or five, which Tim Gabo alluded to at halftime. It's not like they're bringing six and seven. They're bringing four and five, but still pressuring, so the offensive line has got to step up and improve their play.
White to throw, stops, heaves it downfield, picked off by Kyle DeMaster. Needs a block, he got it, and will score again.
Well, that's the bread and butter pass play for Stevenson. But it was not successful. They're going to drag Stowe all the way from the backside, and that's who they're going to. That's just a poorly thrown ball. DeMaster, Johnny on the spot, intercepts it. And it's nice when those guys play two ways, because when they get the ball, they know what to do with it. And those offensive receivers and running backs or defenders in your secondary, they can finish after they make the play.
Nice block, by the way, by Kyle Chobani, the defensive tackle who never gave up and paved the way, allowing DeMaster to score from 51 yards away. It had been all offense for the Cougars before Kyle DeMaster picked off his ninth pass this season, and the All-Metro Detroit News selection rumbled it in for six more. It's 35-7. Tune in next month for tape coverage of the state volleyball final. Saturday, December 15th, it's the Class D and C finals at noon and then at 2. On Saturday, December 22nd, catch the A and B championship matches at 1:30 and 3:30. MHSAA volleyball, December 15th and the 22nd, only here on FSN Detroit. Huge day for Kyle DeMaster offensively and now defensively.
Nice job. Kyle DeMaster really doing a good job. Three catches for over 100 yards, coming in averaging 25.6 yards a catch. He's improving on that today. Really stretching the field, and you wonder how he can do that. Well, the reason is number three in your pitcher by Coach Giannone there, and that's Hush. When you got a weapon on each side like that, as Tim Gobble said, who do you cover? Who do you double? Right. Who do you roll coverage to? If I roll it here, they're going to go there, and vice versa.
Then when you have a tight end splitting it down the middle.
And a quarterback that can put it where it needs to be. And an offensive line that creates a nice pocket. This is a pretty good offense. They're fun to watch.
Yeah, they really are. When Stevenson is on, they're fun to watch too. But they've missed a beat more than once so far here today. Austin White from the 10. Got a seam up the middle. Squirts free to the 40. Bumps off a would-be tackler. He could reach the end zone. Stiff arms his way. Touchdown, Austin White. What a response.
Well, if Stevenson has any hope of coming back in this game, they needed to strike quickly. That's exactly what they do with their sophomore tailback kick return man, Austin White. He's going to take it through the seam with speed. Now he's able to gain his balance, get to the outside, and look at the white shirts not quitting, getting a nice downfield block by Josh Stouts, and then just taking it the rest of the way into the end zone. And it's a touchdown for 23, and in the next 2 years, I got a feeling we'll see a lot more of those as well.
His first kickoff return for a score and the longest return of the sophomore season. Johnny Myshock on for the extra point. It is up and it is through. And the sting that the Spartans were feeling moments ago has subsided for the time being, because Austin White took the kickoff 90 yards to pay dirt and has cut the lead down to 21. Tim Gobble has a lot of weapons at his disposal. There's Mitchell White, Miles White, Austin White. He's been blessed to have this trio in his offense.
Well, the twins are cut from a different cloth than the younger brother. I mean, there's a real togetherness, yet rivalry that kind of follows them through everything. So, you know, you learn kind of to watch them operate. It's different than watching other teammates. The younger brother, like I said, he's a little bit different. They look out for him. All three are very good athletes. They have a tremendous will to win. They work very hard. So it's really a pleasure coaching them.
There's the younger brother, Austin White. You know, his older brothers are looking out for him. They're doing a pretty good job and hasn't been able to make the big plays offensively in terms of big runs. Does have the one rushing touchdown and now that kickoff return for a score. But Tim Gobble working on ways, no doubt, to try and get him more involved.
Yeah, he is. You're going to see him probably split out more, slotted a little bit in the passing game because of the score and the way the game has unfolded. Stevenson's out of their game plan. They can't try to run the ball as much as they would like to. They got to start spreading it out, throwing the ball down the field, taking chances. And that's going to take Austin White out of the equation as a runner, but bring him in as a pass receiver.
Pat York's kickoff is retrieved by Kyle DeMaster. He gets to the 31-yard line, took a big bump from Emmanuel Awomene, and remains down for a moment. You got those stud players like Kyle DeMaster, offense, defense, special teams. You're talking kickoff and kick return.
Oh, yeah.
They don't get a break.
Well, at halftime, I went down and got some popcorn. He sold it to me. So.
Did he?
Yeah, he's working hard.
Hopefully he charged a double because he's earned quite a bit here today.
Defense!
Shelby stumbled forward to the line of scrimmage. Wyatt Stahl came in from the corner to trip him up. That's Joe Palm, slow to get up, the junior center.
You know, we've talked a lot about the skilled players for Dakota, but how about Garza and Doan and Fantuzzi, Palm and Raymond up front, the time they allotted their quarterback to find receivers down the field. These aren't all little three-step quick slants they're throwing. They're throwing some drop-back passes when your offensive line better protect.
Second and nine. Love it with a dart to Hush. Made a man miss. Good run after the catch to get close to the first down. Looks like he has enough from our vantage point.
I think the last time I've seen someone with that type of quickness is Hush. It was years ago when I did the Lowell game. It was Mark Catlin, who was their quarterback, who set the all-time state record for any division for total yards. Well-thrown ball by Lovett. And Hush very seldom gets tackled by the first defender. He usually makes one or two miss and really difficult to bring down in space. Not the biggest in stature now. And Rodney's only 5'8", 5'7", 140 pounds.
5:40 to go in the third. Little inside give to Hush. That has ruled rocked at the 47-yard line by Wyatt Stahl.
That play for the second time in that wing counter. Looks like there's nothing there. It's going to be defended for a loss. And Hush has the ability to stop and then head north and south instead of just trying to keep it going to the edge. And that's ad-libbing that players have of his ability. Coaches, you can't coach that. You just go home at night and say thank you. Whoever's in charge of doling out the personnel.
Second down and six. Lovett wants to throw. Finds Hush again. Another nice move of the feet to get another first down past the 45.
Well, they're just controlling the line of scrimmage. They're controlling the passing game. They're catching the ball. They're just really clicking on all cylinders right now, this Franklin offense. And you see the head coach giving a few words of advice to his quarterback, sending him back in the game. And when a quarterback's rolling like Lovett, you just kind of say, okay, keep doing the same thing. Don't change anything what you're doing right now. You're orchestrating. You're throwing where the ball should be delivered. As a head coach, you just kind of nod your head and let the quarterback do what he does well.
Shelby up the middle, thrown backwards for a loss. Joe Palm was bent over backwards when he kind of had his legs pinned out from underneath him and then thrown back. So you injure some of those knees and tear some of the MCLs. Got to be careful there. When that pile stops, it's important to keep those feet moving. Joe Palm's all right, though. Big number 51 in the middle, 6'2", 265-pounder. Lovett trying to set something up. Now he'll scramble. Breaks a tackle. Got a block from Shelby twice. And nestles down at the 38-yard line. Good block by the tailback. A pickup of six.
Well, they're trying to throw a middle screen here, but the play breaks down. You're going to see the linemen are going to go down in here where the footballs are showing, and they're going to try to get the back Shelby into him. Look him coming back into the area, but there's nothing there. You got to, if you're going to run a middle screen, funnel everything outside, but you got to funnel everything outside. They allow some pressure to seep in, not allowing Lovett to step up and throw the middle screen. And that's the reason it broke down.
Good decision by Lovett not to throw the football. Third down and five. This time he'll throw. Looking downfield. Finds his tight end. Kwiatkowski broke the tackle. This could be a record breaker. Inside the five and out of bounds, but a flag on the play.
We talk about penalties that coaches kind of shake their head at, but they can, you know, kind of look the other way and accept it, and that's going to be one on DeMaster. Down the field after Kwiatkowski makes the catch, trying to make a block 20 yards down the field, but he's going to get a I know they're going to block in the back or clip or what they're going to rule it, but it's going to come back. You can look at number five. He's going to come into your screen right here. That's a tough one as he hits Miles White.
Illegal block in the back. Offense. Going to take it off.
You have no problem as head coach of your receivers trying to spring your tight end 30 yards down the field. And that was really an edgy call for the fact that Miles White dipped his shoulder a little bit right before DeMaster made the block, which made it a little bit worse looking than it actually was. The official in good position makes the call. Ends up still be a first down because it happened down the field as a spot foul.
So the ball rests at the 29-yard line on Lavonia Stevenson with 3:08 left to go in the third. Trips to the left of Mitch Lovett. They go on the ground with Shelby. Fumble. It's loose. Who's got it? Macomb Dakota jumped all over it. The center, Joe Palm, recovered it.
You just have to listen to the crowd if you're not sure who recovered it, because when the ball went loose, everyone on our side, the Stevenson side, screams. And then all of a sudden you reach out and grab it and they become quiet.
Kind of pawing at it there. Chris Galanka knocked it loose, but Joe Palm was there, used those big long pliers and brought it in. Keep the drive alive with a second down and 8.
Was a pretty smooth running game in the first half. With a few penalties, is kind of slowed down almost to a halt here. The whistles have started to blow, the flags are starting to fly, and yards are beginning to be stepped off.
Illegal motion against Macomb Dakota.
Dead ball, false start on the offense. Second down.
So second down and 13 now for the Cougars on this, the ninth play of the drive. It started back on their own 32-yard line. Lovett will throw. Has a lane and some room. Thrown out of bounds at the 25-yard line.
Still, Lovett has to scramble out of the pocket, but the protection is solid. He had to scramble after about 4 seconds standing in the pocket, some late pressure applied. He saw an opening, he took off down the field, was able to pick up about 6 yards, so a positive play. Stevenson has been unable to generate pressure with their front four, their front five.
Yeah.
And, you know, we always talk about, Matt, when you can pressure with four, you're going to have a really good opportunity to win in football if you limit your turnovers, because quarterbacks, it disrupts the passing game, it disrupts the running game.
Third down and 5 right now for the Cougars with 1:40 to go in the third. A pump fake now for the end zone. DeMaster leaps. There it is. The record breaker for Mitch Lovett. 5 touchdown passes on the day.
Well, there's your new state record holder. 5 touchdown passes by Mitch Lovett. We talked in the highlighted in the open. Mitch Lovett, with the two weapons that he's has to work with, and they have not let us down here today between DeMaster and Hush. Terrific.
The extra point is no good. So Mitch Lovett with a new record. Kyle DeMaster has tied 5 others with his third touchdown grab of the game. 41-14, the defending champs in a blowout. Mitch Lovett will be the first to congratulate his offensive line for helping him establish a new state finals record.
Well, Mitch Lovett, really should give credit to his receivers, maybe more important. Look at this offensive line. There's no pressure. He's got all day, great vision. Look at this lane down the field. He sees it. And then it's just, I really start to feel for Mark Grysa. Because, you know, he's been left on an island, and there it is. That's what the MHSA championships are all about.
Austin White with a nice congratulations. Yep. Not only has Mitch Lovett set a new state record for touchdown passes with five, but a new state single game record in a finals game for most passing yards with 295.
Oh, look at that jersey. Who's that remind you of? Your favorite quarterback in the NFL. Looks like the Indianapolis Colts, almost calling the Baltimore Colts. I mean, showing off. Yeah,
if he was wearing a number 18, you're right on.
Yeah.
Jack Trudeau? No, I'm just kidding. 41-14. You know, he's not the only one to set a state record either, and we'll get to that in a moment after the kickoff. Adam Mazza will kick it deep. Out of a punch kick that'll be fielded at the 21-yard line and dropped at the 30-yard line. Stevenson ready to go to work. Talked about Mitch Lovett setting records. Same with Kyle DeMaster. He has four touchdowns on the day. That ties a finals game record. Three receiving touchdowns. That ties a finals game record as well. Tough to do what you're supposed to do now if you're the Spartans. Austin White stymied again after a pickup of a couple by Kyle DeMaster.
We don't want to think that Tim Gobble, the head coach of Stevens, is waving the white flag. I think he may get, I don't want to say more conservative, but he may implement his running game, realizing that we're just barely over a quarter left and trailing by, 27 points. The chance of his team coming back right now is pretty slim. So he's going to eat a little bit of clock and run the ball and give his kids an opportunity to do what they do well.
Dennis Swift into the ball game for Lavonia Stevenson, replacing Miles White. This is Wade Stahl. Stahl, a nice block. A stiff arm gets to the 45 and out of bounds at the 46.
Now, Stahl hasn't been a big part of this offense today, but the few opportunities he's had to carry the football, he's looked pretty good.
Yeah.
He looks like he has pretty decent speed, probably the quickest of the three guys that have been carrying the ball. And you can look here. This is just that wing counter they've run today about two or three times. He's able to get the edge. He does a nice job of dipping it in and then getting it back outside. See Hush coming up, knocking him out of bounds. But I like Wade Stahl. I think he shows pretty good speed for a junior now. He's got another year, so he's going to be coming back. I'm sure he's going to be a big part of Tim Gobble's success next year.
Average 8 yards per carry running the ball, 17 yards per catch receiving. Now in motion. Fake the toss to him. The inside give is sniffed out and getting thrown down. Charles Martin, Mike Laminen, dumping Austin White for another loss.
Well, it's all about defensive line getting penetration into the backfield. They're trying to run the inside counter coming back, but Laminen was having nothing to do with it. His buddy Charles Martin decided to join in the party a little bit. And 2-on-1. Is never a good thing for a running back when you got two big defensive linemen coming at you.
It's a good ball club, isn't it? Second down and 13. Stahl again in motion, the short toss. Good room and a good run to the 40. A pickup of 17 for Wade Stahl. But right now, the flag carrying Dakota Cougars are well on their way to a second straight title. Records are being shattered at Ford Field in a 41-14 lead for Macomb, Dakota. HSA football finals on FSN Detroit are brought to you by Eastern Michigan University. Education first. And by Officials for Kids. High school game officials improving the quality of hospital care for kids across the state. 12 minutes away from crowning our second state champion, here on FSN Detroit, here at Ford Field. Welcome back to the Division I state title game, all in favor of Macomb Dakota, whose third quarter kind of separated themselves a little bit from the Spartans. From Lavonia Stevenson, Austin White trying to box it to the outside. They string him out and knock him out after he picks up the first down. Justin Hughes and Chris Hutchins in on the push out.
Austin White demonstrated pretty good speed getting to the outside. I also like the fact that this young kid, only a sophomore, already started to implement that stiff arm a little bit. That's something that's hard to teach young men. I think it's a lost art for a running back, using that stiff arm, fending off people coming at you. Pretty decent numbers. I mean, you know, 30 yards, 90 return yards, not what he would like to have done today. But if everyone else is contributing on an offense, he's done his part. The problem is they're not getting any yards, any production anywhere else.
Had 176 yards and two TDs against Troy last week. That included an 80-yard touchdown run. Had a 90-yard touchdown sprint here today. His brother goes to work. A fly ball for miles wide, and it's knocked down by the opponent, number three, Rodney Hush. It's been a hard time trying to get Miles White involved in the offense.
You can see what we talk about all the time. Be a receiver when you're a defender. Make a play on the ball. Go up, attack it at its highest point. This happens to be that Mr. Hush is a pretty good receiver, and he demonstrated his skills going after that as a defender, knocking it down.
Cougars allowing just 10 points per game in the postseason. So their defense, we talk a lot about their offense, their defense has really come to play. Third down and about five after the minimal gain from Emmanuel Awimene. Really test your concentration right now if you're Lavonia Stevenson, doesn't it, Rob? I mean, your club is in a huge hole. Time is winding down. You've been, for the most part, dominated. Staring at a third down and five, but we'll have to wait. A timeout from Macomb, Dakota. We've got 11:07 left to go in the Division I state championship game. Tim Gobble's club in a whole lot of hurt right now on the downside of a 41-14 score. This broadcast of this game is a copyrighted presentation of the Michigan High School Athletic Association and FSN Detroit. No reproduction, retransmission, or other distribution of the images, descriptions, or accounts of this game may take place without the express written consent of the MHSAA and FSN Detroit. A little bit later on, just shy of the 4:30 mark, Jackson Lumen Christie and Menominee for Division 5, Lumen Christie, 7 state titles. And then the late game, Division 3, it's Orchard Lake St. Mary's against East Grand Rapids, who won it a year ago and also has 7 state titles.
And a couple of dandies coming up.
Third and 5, pressure coming from behind. White gets it rid of it, and it's incomplete. Too high for Awimene. Chris Chase again applying the pressure from the backside.
How many times have you called a play for Stevenson and not say the word pressure? As Mitchell White drops back into the pocket, once again, he wants to throw, but the edge is shut down. He tries to step up, and then the defensive tackle's getting his face. Almost has to make a little bit of a jump throw, causing a little bit of an accurate pass, and it's up a 4th and 5.
Sometimes that's all it takes, right? You talked about making the quarterback feel uncomfortable. Obviously, he wasn't comfortable with that set. 4th and 5 now. Again, dark blue jerseys chasing him, and he throws it away. It'll go over on down to the Cougars.
You know, we talked a lot about the skill players once again, but this is a dominance by the fronts of Franklin over Stevenson right now. This defensive line has totally taken charge of this game. As Mitchell White drops back in the pocket, the blue shirts are dropping back almost as quickly as he has. And the smaller offensive line, I mean, you look at Travis Austin, Joe Cantrell, both are 5'8", 5'9", and Ricky Bell, 6-foot center for Stevenson. And they've struggled with Charles Martin, 246-1, Shabani, also 240 pounds. So the bigger line of Dakota is starting to take over.
Lovett remains in the game. Same with Shelby, who got lit up by Pat York. Two unbeatens in this Division I state final. Both clubs running the table after 13 games. 10.5 to go before Macomb Dakota finishes 14-0. Yesterday, you and I witnessed Detroit Martin Luther King finish 14-0 and route to their first ever title. I'll keep it on the ground. You can hear the pads popping all the way from here. Mike Giannone not satisfied yet. He and his staff continue to coach him up.
Obviously letting air out of the ball now offensively. I think, you know, definitely a sign of class. You're not trying to, 48 doesn't prove anything. 55 points, that's not what you need. What you need is more points than your opponent. That's what Mike Giannone realizes. So he's run the ball here in the first couple of downs, and now if he wants to put it up in order to move the chains, it's quite acceptable.
He'll do just that and complete it to move him one more time. Dan Miller's first catch of the afternoon.
Yeah, it's nice to call Dan Miller's name. Been doing a lot of the grunt work at the tight end position, pass blocking and so forth. Used sparingly for the fact that Kwiatkowski has been so effective.
Another big target though, 6'4", 205.
Another senior, get him an opportunity to get a little air time. Oh, I'm sorry. It would be a junior rather than a senior for Dan Miller. Also fine broadcaster for the Detroit Lions.
Here's Mitch Lovett with a give to Terrence Shelby, stifled at the line of scrimmage.
Young man right there. Doesn't have the touchdowns, doesn't have the big numbers today. Has, you know, been quietly having a fine day running the ball, getting what's there, also in pass protection. He's one of the reasons they've had time to throw the ball down the field.
Just tough, 3 yards per carry, but you're right, between the tackles.
And you look at those yards, 61 yards on 20 carries, I would imagine 30 or 40 of those were after first contact.
Yeah. Stumbles his way close to the 45. He's also protected the ball pretty well, Rob.
That's important. Don't turn the ball or don't get the short fields. Another third down and four situation. So last time Dakota was able to hit a little quick hitch outside to Dan Miller, move the chains. I don't think that anyone wants to see this clock go much faster than either head coach right now. I think Coach Gabo realizes that the better team is going to come away with the victory here today. His kids have fought tough.
Yep.
They've played their hearts out, but
now the Spartans defense, you know, during the regular season round, they gave up 88 points. So far in the postseason, not including this game, 84. So something's going on.
A little bit of scheduling, maybe the conference they're in is not as difficult as we talked about the Macomb League being one of the better leagues in the conference,
sure,
with Eisenhower and Sterling Heights Stevenson and Macomb. Is there Chippewas?
Chippewa Valley's
in there as well. So that's four pretty good teams that have all made trips here.
Yeah.
So you come out of that, you already played a pretty much a tournament schedule during the regular season.
Rodney Hush on to punt for what, the first time since the first quarter. Just the second punt of the day for Rodney Hush. Hits out of bounds at about the 31-yard line. We have 6:43 remaining in the fourth with Dakota moments away from another celebration. Impressive offensive and defensive display by the defending champion Cougars from Macomb, Dakota. 6:43 away from celebrating back-to-back titles. Big Nassies up front on the offense and defensive line, Rob. Don't get a whole lot of love, but today they deserve an awful lot of credit.
They sure do. They've been the reason why Dakota's on the upside of this 41-14 game right now.
Stevenson back to work. Miles White with the two touchdowns for the Spartans.